Justice. Well, that's our theme today, known and called to justice. Welcome to Suncoast Metropolitan Community Church. We're so glad to welcome you on this beautiful sunny day. It's warming up slightly today, so that feels wonderful. Let's give a warm welcome to those who are worshiping online. And if you're online with us this morning, please let us know in the chat where you're from, where you're worshiping from, maybe how many people are with you. And if you have any special prayer requests, and if you're joining us this morning and you're new with us and you did not get a welcome packet, will you please raise your hand? Otherwise, oh, very good. Everyone's taken care of. Oh, there's one here. Did not get a welcome packet. Oh, Jean. Okay. I should have known. There you go. Okay. Well, we're very glad to welcome you to this place where we teach and practice truth, trust, and transformation. So God bless you this morning as we come and hear our announcements.
Not used to that in this church. Good morning. Next Sunday, please join us as a welcome to Dr. April Glasgow as a guest preacher. She is the founder and CEO of the Second Chance in Sarasota. She has an amazing story to share and is a great way to start Black History Month. February 2nd, we will be having a potluck and prayer service. Please bring a friend in a dish. If you are looking for a gently used solid oak desk, we would love to offer this to a member or friend of the church before advertising it to the public. It's approximately 6 foot by 4 foot. It can be yours for a $150 donation to the church. You will need to arrange to pick it up. We don't deliver. Contact the church if you'd like to come take a look. We will advertise to the public after a couple of weeks, so don't delay. The next Congregational Care Team meeting is scheduled for this Wednesday, February 1st at 3 p.m. The February month at a glance is ready to download or to pick up a copy in the lobby. And now Cindy Dorenko will come and share some information.
Good morning. One goal of our strategic plan centers around social justice issues. We will be approaching this on three levels: educate, advocate, and activate. In the coming weeks, you will hear more about how our team will be addressing all three of them and learn ways you can participate. Conducting a book club via Zoom will be one of the ways we educate ourselves more about social issues. In an effort to align our book choices with the calendar, our February book will introduce a fictionalized version of a real African-American woman from history. Our book will be The Invention of Wings by Sue Monk Kidd. One reviewer writes the following: Sue Monk Kidd presents a masterpiece of hope, daring, the quest for freedom, and the desire to have a voice in the world. Hetty Handful Grimke, an urban slave in early 19th century Charleston, yearns for life beyond the suffocating walls that enclose her within the wealthy Grimke family. The Grimke's daughter, Sarah, has known from an early age she is meant to do something large in the world, but she is hemmed in by the limits imposed on women. Imagine. Kidd's sweeping novel is set in motion on Sarah's 11th birthday when she is gifted ownership of the 10-year-old Handful, who is to be her handmaid. We follow their remarkable journey over the next 35 years. This exquisite novel is a triumph of storytelling that looks with an unswerving eye at the devastating wound in American history through women whose struggles for liberation, empowerment, and expression will leave no reader unmoved. We will be conducting our first book club discussion on this book on Monday, February 20th at 7 o'clock via Zoom only. The information will be reviewed and staying connected over the next few weeks with information needed to connect to the Zoom. So get your books and plan to join us. I bought a few extra and I have them with me for $10. So if anybody wants to buy one today, see me. And if you don't have the $10, I'll find you. Not to worry. Thank you. I hope everyone will consider joining in this social justice adventure.
So I actually get to lead the advocate part of that team, and next month we'll be starting workshops on how to advocate, who to contact, how to contact them, what to say, and what happens when you do contact them. So if you have any questions about advocacy, and this is more on law, either state, federal, or local, please reach out and ask, particularly if you have questions that you want to have answered. So finally, masks are optional for worship and indoor events. Just a reminder that flu and cold season is here, and we encourage everyone to get their flu shots and COVID boosters. Please remember to stay home if you're sick, for this is for your health and the safety of everybody. Check out the website and the weekly Staying Connected for additional information on ways to stay involved. And now, if you would stand, now let's take a minute to greet each other safely. On the count of three, open your arms wide and extend a warm welcome to all joining us in person and online. One, two, three. It's true, they all can count up to three.
Grant us a vision of your world as your love would have it.
A world where the weak are protected and none go hungry or poor.
A world where the riches of creation are shared and everyone can enjoy them.
A world where different races and cultures live in harmony and mutual respect.
A world where peace is built with justice and justice is guided by love.
Please rise as you're able and join us in singing Enter, Rejoice, and Come In.
Rejoice and come in. and come in. Today will be a joyful day. Enter, rejoice, and come in.
Please be seated.
Let us hear the wisdom from the prophet Amos. Seek good, not evil, that you may live. Then God Almighty will be with you, just as you say God is. Hate evil, love good. Maintain justice in the courts. Perhaps God Almighty will have mercy on the remnant of Joseph. God's word for God's people. Rise as you are able for the gospel reading. Luke 4:14, chapters 14 through 21. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day, he went into a synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of God is on me, because God has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. God has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of our God's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. He began by saying to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." The gospel of Jesus Christ for us. Amen.
Would you harbor me? Would I harbor you? A person living with AIDS.
So for before I start with the message, I do want to remind you of a couple of things. Now, there is a social event team planning meeting today, right after church in the library. This Thursday is our prayer and potluck. People are finding that very meaningful. It starts at 5:30 here at church. You can bring a dish to share. If you don't have time to bring a dish to share, just come, because there'll be plenty. There's always enough food to send home. So, and then it's kind of an informal time of prayer after we share a meal together. That's this Thursday. And something else that we're excited about is our upcoming church anniversary on February 19th. How many of you know how old we're going to be? 28. 28. I heard 6. So 28, I think, right? 28. Yeah. We're going to be 28 years old, and we are setting a goal, an attendance goal, and we need your help to make sure we reach that goal. We want to have 80 plus, emphasis on the plus, here physically in worship. And for you on loan folks, you're not off the hook, because we want 40 plus, emphasis on the plus, online people viewing on that day. So February 19th, be sure to be here for that and help us surpass our goal. Would you pray with me? Loving, gracious God, as we turn our hearts and our minds to your word, your call, your will, I ask, O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, this morning we continue our Known and Called series, where we are hearing the stories about who Jesus was and is in an attempt to be encouraged and challenged by his life. And upon hearing the stories, or being reminded of them and the principles by which governed his life, it is the hope that we will be inspired once again, or renewed once again, by these stories to do similarly today. Our topic today is one that's near and dear to my heart, and probably to many of you as well, and that topic is justice. And to begin, I want to give us a simplified definition for the term social justice, and that definition is justice in terms of the distribution of wealth, opportunities, and privileges within a society. In a just society, everyone would receive fair, equitable, and impartial treatment and have access to the same outcome. Working for justice is not new to many of us in MCC. We've worked for social justice issues since our founding, quite truthfully. I'm confident in saying that Reverend Nancy has attended and participated in more demonstrations, rallies, and other events pertaining to social justice than she can count or remember. And although I've not attended or participated in near as many as those that Nancy has, I too have participated and attended numerous rallies, demonstrations, and events pertaining to social justice issues, more than I can count or remember. One of the first experiences I had in working for social justice, namely marriage equality, was when I served on staff with Reverend Nancy at Church of the Trinity in Sarasota. MCC Global was encouraging churches, MCCs, on Valentine's Day or near or around Valentine's Day to go to courthouses with same-sex couples and encourage them to apply for marriage licenses, which of course we knew would be denied. Guess who was out of town for that? So guess who got assigned their first social justice event? So I took two lesbian couples to the courthouse in Sarasota, along with a lot of like-minded people from the church, the media. And we went in to apply for marriage licenses for these two same-gender couples. And of course, they were denied. And so we turned around and we walked outside the courthouse, and I performed both of their ceremonies right there on the courthouse lawn. That particular story happened to get picked up by the Associated Press. Nothing like your first social justice endeavor being picked up by news medias all across the United States. It was good. It was an amazing thing for me, because I have to admit, my partner at the time was totally against it. He said, "You're going to get shot." Could have been, I guess. We know that that does happen. And I was very nervous. But I remember stepping out of my vehicle there in Sarasota, and the minute I stepped on the courthouse grounds and saw all of these other people with like-minded support gathering around us, I felt energized. I felt empowered and encouraged that, yes, this is what it is about. And all of that fear banished, and we confidently went in and did the task set before us. Since that time, I've attended many other demonstrations, and not just for marriage equality. I was one of the speakers for women's rights when we were in Augusta, Georgia. I remember we demonstrated in Naples several years ago about equal pay for the immigrants in Immokalee, and lots of different causes and so forth that we have participated in. I've stood on more street corners with signs for equality and banners than I can remember. Being mindful of and working for social justice doesn't necessarily mean standing on street corners with signs, banners, and flags, although it might for you. Social justice involves our doing all that we can to provide a level playing field and equal treatment and opportunities for all members of society, no matter their race, ethnicity, religious affiliation, or no religious affiliation, their gender identity, sexual orientation, gender expression, and so on. For me, social justice has biblical roots in the Trinity, or the triune God, who time and time again shows love and compassion for the weak, the vulnerable, the marginalized, the disenfranchised, the disinherited. Tim Dearborn writes in Reflections on Advocacy and Justice, quote, "For Christians, the pursuit of social justice for the poor and oppressed is the decisive mark of being people who desire to do the will and way of God," end quote. Biblical references to the word justice mean to make right. Justice is, first and foremost, a relational term. People living in right relationship with God, one another, and the natural creation. From a scriptural point of view, justice means loving our neighbor as we love ourselves, for this is the very character and nature of God. As God is just and loving, so we are called to do justice and live in love. As spiritual people, the building blocks of social justice lie in human dignity, human flourishing, and the sacredness of life. The source of social justice is God's perfect righteousness, justice, and radical love. Our world desperately needs social justice, not to mention our state of Florida. And part of the vehicle for seeing social justice realized will be through people of faith. I truly believe that. Through you and me and all who long to see true equality and justice. People need us to be the conduit of the presence of a strong God, the humanness of Jesus, and the ability to make a difference by the empowerment of Spirit. The Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 12, verse 9, that we should hate that which is evil and cling to that which is good. I trust we are hating the injustices and inequalities that are happening in Florida, our country, and in the world. And if not, I would remind us of the words of Jesus found in Luke chapter 4, which we read this morning. In Luke's gospel, we find Jesus in Nazareth, where he had been raised. And on the Sabbath, he went into the synagogue and he opened the scroll of the prophet Isaiah and began reading from our modern day chapter 61. He talks about releasing the oppressed, setting people free. The ministry of Jesus was defined by the voice of Israel's prophets in many ways. And that voice pointed to a need for societal level justice and for individuals to live justly. For Israel's prophets, belief in God and social justice was inseparable. Listen to these words found in Isaiah 58. Is it not this, the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Isaiah 1:17 says, learn to do good, seek justice, rescue the oppressed, defend the orphan, plead for the widow. Jesus, guided by Spirit and using the words of Israel's prophets, proved that all humans have worth. When he lived on earth, no one was his special pet because of riches or poverty. Rank and social distinction meant nothing to Jesus. It was for all humanity. We preach that. We say that. We believe that. That it was for all humanity that Christ cared, loved, and loved. And if we are to be Christ-like, then we too should have the same passions and convictions of Christ. Jesus says that his purpose for coming to earth as a human being was to set the oppressed free. And some would say, well, this is just simply to mean that he came to spiritually set people free. But I submit to us today that if we are oppressed in any way whatsoever, then we are not completely free, even spiritually. Oppression and injustices in our world limits the freedom of those who are being held down, and this is not acceptable in the eyes of Jesus and should not be acceptable to us. In Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 12, he talks about the body of Christ being one entire unit working together. It's familiar to most people, I would think. He says in verse 26, if one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. If we are all part of the body, you know, when we stub our toe, it's not just our toe that feels hurt, right? I mean, our whole body is like, yikes, you know? The same goes with the body of Christ. When one is hurting, when one is oppressed, we are all hurting and oppressed. Still today, in 2023, black and brown people are suffering. People of other ethnicities are suffering. The LGBTQIA community is suffering. Women are suffering. And all who are disenfranchised and marginalized are suffering. Factions of society feed and fuel discrimination. And some of that feeding and fueling, unfortunately, comes from those who claim to know Jesus. But rather than really know him, it seems they have hijacked Jesus and spew hateful speech in Jesus' name. When I believe Jesus is grieved by their actions. But the faith community that is fair-minded and justice-seeking must continue to rise up and say, enough is enough. If we don't do it, who will? In Micah 6:8, we read, "What does our God require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with God?" Jesus came to earth to show humanity the way to God and how to live in ways that make a difference in society. He called out injustices. He showed compassion and extended mercy. How are we to live? What are we to do? We are to conduct our lives similarly to the way Jesus conducted his life, inspired by the wisdom, concern, and care of the prophets of old. We are to do good, seek justice, rescue the oppressed, defend the weak, plead for the marginalized and disenfranchised, work for equality and fairness for all people. Did you know that part of the MCC Global Vision says, "We are called to develop and equip leaders, congregations, and ministries to do the work of justice, compassion, and the integration of sexuality and spirituality, gender identity, and expression." That's taken from the MCC Global Mission. The mission statement of our denomination has the following statement: "Following the example of Jesus and empowered by the Spirit, we demand, proclaim, and do justice in the world." And the core values of MCC Global, we read, "Working to talk less and do more, we are committed to resisting the structures that oppress people and standing with those who suffer under the weight of oppressive systems, being guided always by our commitment to global human rights." And in case you were wondering, social justice is part of our strategic plan, as Cindy mentioned. Sue Monk Kidd, what a great author. I strongly encourage, I've not read that book, but I'm looking forward to reading it. She did Secret Life of Bees. She's a great author. But Suncoast, MCC, our mission statement also includes social justice. It reads, "Through God's unconditional love, we invite all people to experience a community filled with an advocacy for social justice." So as Reverend Nancy says, that was a long introduction to a short sermon. So the intro is over. So now I have 4 points. How do we make a difference in advocating for social justice? Here's 4 ways. And they're just suggestions, but to kind of help. Number one, we can contact our legislators through email. Jay mentioned that already. Written letters and phone calls, speaking against all levels of discrimination. Number two, see, I told you, it's quick points. We can attend organized demonstrations when possible to show our solidarity and support. As I mentioned earlier, there is something to say when I stepped out of my vehicle in Sarasota that day and saw so many other people. There is power in that. There is power in supporting one another and realizing we are not alone. When I first came out as a gay man, I went and sat in the corner of a gay bar and realized, oh my gosh, I'm not alone. There's more of us. Solidarity and support is powerful. Number three, we can have conversations with family, friends, acquaintances, and non-argumentative ways to share our hearts as to why we feel social justice is so important. It's not about fighting and arguing with people. In fact, it's the opposite. It's about when they go low, we go high. And it's about having adult-like conversations, sharing, this is why I believe what I believe. And this is why social justice is so important to me. And number four, we can pray. 1, 2, and 3 are just as important as 4. because it does take our action. We are people of prayer. We are a church that believes in prayer. Amen. In closing, let us seek the power of Almighty God to be with us and to help us along our journey in advocating for social justice. Let us look to the human Jesus and follow his example in showing human kindness, care, and compassion to all people, even those we may be tempted to cast aside or ignore. And let us be open to Spirit to fill us and use us to do good, seek justice, rescue the oppressed, defend the weak, plead for the marginalized and disenfranchised. For in so doing, we will be known by our call to seek justice in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. Jesus, you intentionally, purposely, and passionately addressed very specific causes. You radically addressed the diverse and complicated conflicts of your time and shattered the status quo. You addressed specific political, social, and racial issues, and you helped those who are being abused, violated, and oppressed. We thank you for showing us what it means to resist oppression and to work for justice and inclusion. Challenge us, inspire us, and encourage us by your Spirit to follow your example by doing our part to see all people are treated fairly, with dignity and respect. Be our light as we endeavor to be seekers of justice.
Light, shine in.
lift our celebrations and joys in praise and thanksgiving to you this morning. We are thankful that you are faithful to be with us in all things. We celebrate your presence with us at all times. And we now turn our hearts and minds to the needs and concerns we are lifting to you this morning. You know every situation and circumstance we face. I ask you to bear with me for a moment. If you read my Facebook page, at times you'll see, "How long, O Lord, must we keep waiting?" And I wrote that last weekend on the occasion of something that was on the news. And then I read this morning about this incident, which kind of really, pissed me off. The officer's demeanors seem untroubled and their work non-urgent as they mill at this quiet corner, trading battle tales, a fist bump, and a back pat. The police ranks have ballooned, but everyone seems to agree there is nothing to see here. They tie their boots and fret over their glasses and complain about knee pain. So you might have missed him there among the tall, towering policemen above him, the ones who wear a smile and spurt laughter and will go home safe. Look past the men who punched, kicked, shocked, sprayed, dragged, and now stand in seeming indifference. Let your eyes drift downward, and the crumpled body comes into view. Hands behind his back, one shoe off, he writhes helplessly on the pavement. His screams seem to have ended, his cries for mother have stopped, and his voice has weakened so much his words are hard to discern. This was the death of Tyre Nichols from Memphis, Tennessee. Surprisingly or not, the five policemen were men of color. I believe they were accused of murder. So please pray for all the injustices in the world. We pray for those who have yet to find you and experience your love. We pray for those who are feeling spiritually depleted. Send your spirit to them and fill them with your holy presence. We pray for those who are experiencing lack. Provide for them in ways they wouldn't imagine. We seek healing and strength for those who are ill or experiencing a health challenge of any kind. We seek provision for all our needs and the needs of those we love. We pray for the needs of those listed on our chat line and for those needs on our prayer wall. Surround us all with your love and presence. Strengthen us by your Spirit, we pray. In your many names and the name of Jesus, we say, Amen. Now please rise as you are able as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Creator,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Praying, Christ be our light.
Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through.
going to call forth three people who are ready to join our church today. Peter and Sonny and Mark, please come forward. You can face the congregation. All right. Yes. Oh, are you ready? Come on up. Patty and Pat. So, get their stuff from behind the pulpit. Come on up. All right. This is Pat and Patty. And, yes. Come on. There we go. Yeah. You just put that over there if you want, whatever. All right.
Okay.
Anyone else? There we go.
All right.
Go ahead.
So, do you believe in God our Creator, Christ our Redeemer, and in the Holy Spirit our Sustainer? And do you attempt to follow the teachings and example of Jesus in your daily life? If so, your response should be, I do.
And have you been baptized in accordance with our Christian faith? If so, your response should be, I have.
Believing that Christianity is experienced in a faith community that supports and strengthens our spiritual lives and that learns from us as we learn from it, do you promise to live and share with the members of Suncoast MCC? If so, your response should be, with God's help, I will.
As you unite with this church, will you worship, serve, and share in its ministry, supporting the church with your earnest prayers, regular attendance, loyal service, and faithful stewardship? And will you work together with your Christian brothers and sisters in love and harmony to promote God's dominion in this world? If so, your response should be, with God's help, I will.
And now to the members and friends of the congregation. Will the members and friends of the church please rise as you are able? Beloved, we commend to your care these persons whom we receive this day as members of this congregation. Will you welcome them into this community of faith? If so, please respond, we will.
We will.
And will you love them, support them, nurture them, and help them grow in the life of Christ? If so, please respond, with God's help, we will.
With God's help, we will.
Do you grant them the full rights and responsibilities as active voting members of Suncoast MCC? If so, please respond with, we do.
We do.
All right. Get some anointing on here. All right. And please join me in prayer as I anoint these new members. God, we bless these new members. We thank you for the richness that they will bring to us. We thank you for their courage and standing before you and this congregation to say yes to being a part of our church community. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And now by the authority invested in me, by this congregation, I declare that you are full voting members of Suncoast MCC. Give them a big hand.
Certificate of membership and Reverend Nancy's book.
All right, thank you.
Welcome.
All right, one more hand for them. Go ahead. Okay.
Been asked to do the offertory this morning. My whole life, I've been active in my church, many churches through my many, many decades of life. And I've always been a regular supporter of those churches. Many times through my life, I've not just given some of my treasure, but I've given time and talent, sometimes a great deal of that, depending on the situation and the church. I know Roger has done the same. Was called on suddenly this week to be our music director, our piano director, and he's devoted his whole week to trying to be ready to, as he says, enhance your worship experience. I have found, we have found, no matter what we give, God's bountiful blessings are just so much more. It's in just so much more. I've realized that all through my life. Such a blessing. That's even true in the down parts of life, the sad, tough, sorrowful times of life. At least then, I always realized I had my faith. As your treasurer and a member of your board, I can't tell you how grateful I and all the board are for your generous contributions, your donations. The operating donations that fund the operating expenses of all the ministries of this incredible church. Your crafty group, though, we find that week after week, the operating expenses are up here, and the operating revenue, your donations are down here. I thought about, it had been many years since I walked into a McDonald's, but what, imagine walking in McDonald's, ordering a Big Mac and a soda, and a young person behind the counter would say, that's $4, and I would put down $3 or $3.50. Imagine the look on that young person's face. Well, operating expenses for all the ministries of this church cost us $4,000 to $5,000 a week. And we bring in about $3,000 to $4,000. So they're, as I say, you're a crafty group. So what we do is twice a year for the Easter offering and the Christmas offering, we ask, we have a major fund drive to supplement the, so we can cover those operating expenses and keep the ministries of this church alive. So during Lent, when the Easter offering comes up, and the next Advent, when the Christmas offering comes up, please consider what you can do to help keep the ministries of this church and the expenses, operating expenses, covered. We're blessed to have savings in this church, designated funds that can cover us when we're, if the operating revenue is short. But as you all know, when you got to dip into your savings, that's not a good way to live your life financially. As I say, God's blessings have been so much. You all are a blessing. This incredible personification of the body of Christ that is Suncoast MCC, right here on the corner of Jackson and East Venice Avenue, is a miracle. May you continue your generosity, increase it if you can, so that this church can grow and thrive and prosper. God bless you. Namaste. I recognize the divine in each of you. Thank you.
shine your light into those difficult and dark places. And we give you thanks for all the giving that happens in this place and through this place. Blessed be the gifts and blessed be the givers. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
If you are watching online, I invite you to gather your bread and juice as we prepare for communion. For those of you gathered here today, I invite you to retrieve your communion packet. If you didn't get one, please raise your hand for an usher. If anybody needs one, please. There are two seals, one for the bread and one for the juice. Unseal the top seal and wait until instructed for us to consume together.
The Holy One be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to our God.
Let us give thanks to our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Jesus, you spoke against injustices committed toward the disenfranchised, the marginalized, and those who are considered less than in your day. Just as you called those early followers to justice and love, you call us to the same today. Help us to live lives that represent the radical ways of justice and inclusion you demonstrated. Jesus, it was you who reached across human borders and boundaries, seeing in everyone a common heritage as a child of God. Strengthen us as we journey, as we learn and relearn the stories of Jesus. Help us reconnect to you and be filled with the light of your divine and holy presence as we sing together. For everyone born, place at the table. For everyone born, in water and bread. A shelter, a state, a safe place for growing. For everyone born, a sorrow.
Thanks, O God, for the mighty sweep of your love that embraces all people and all nations. Pour out your calling, especially on MCC churches worldwide today. Raise up disciples and leaders who will grow your church. Work for justice and witness to the gospel that is deep and wide, and that includes all.
On the night in which Jesus was betrayed in an upper room with his disciples, he took bread and blessed it and broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Take and eat this, and when you do, remember me."
After supper, Jesus took the cup of salvation, blessed it, and offered it to them, saying, "This is the new covenant in my love, offered for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And so, this morning, with faith and hope as your people, we proclaim together that
Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again.
Let us pray. Bless this meal that we share together today. May the same spirit of love and justice that hovered over those first disciples hover over us as we embrace this table today. May we follow with the same passion and commitment. Fill us with courage to work and be known as seekers of justice.
At all MCCs around the world, we welcome everyone to this table, regardless of where you are on life's journey. Today we come together to celebrate at this table. These are God's gifts for us, God's people. Whether you are participating from home or gathered here, Please now consume the bread and juice. As we do so, may we experience God's love and blessing.
God, this meal we share together is a remembrance of your grace in sending Jesus. May we be strengthened as we move forward together, striving to be known as seekers of justice in this world, for it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now please rise as you're able, and as we sing our closing song, you'll know this one, This Little Light of Mine.
Now may we go from this place, letting our lights shine for justice. Amen.
And it all comes down to this, what you require of me. Above all things, action.